Recording, this will be posted online like usual. Alright, so today we'll switch gear from assembly and start to learn about more on the hardware side. How do we deal with the memory, right? Because we've been talking a lot about memory. Many things we do involve memory. But before I begin, a quick announcement. You might have seen it on Canvas already. You have now an option to redo your midterm for the C question. Hopefully it will work for everyone here. So as to many of you want to retry, I guess raise your hand if you want to retry that, please. Everyone here don't want to redo Q2 and Q3. You got it correct. Like, anyone want to retry doing Q2 and Q3? There's a few people. Okay. I know you did it. So if you want to retry, you can get up to basically 100%. Like, if you get it correctly, you'll get full credit for that question. And you can pick. If, say, you finish implementing the sorted list and you don't want to touch it, that's fine. Then you submit Q2, which is the quick sort. If you say, hey, I did quick sort, and I feel like I screwed up on the sorted list, you can choose to just redo Q3. If you choose not to redo, you get 50% as whatever grade you have right now for the question as an extra credit to be added to the exam. So if you somehow at the end of the day, you got more than 100 points, that's also extra credit at the half going. Basically, let's say you score 106, you'll get 3 points extra credit for the final. One quick thing about redo, collaboration is allowed. I really want to make sure you learn how to actually implement this thing, right? So what do I mean by collaboration? Don't look at your friend's code, but let's say some of you might have finished implementing your solution and you think it's correct. Feel free to actually help your friends in a way that, for example, if you got stuck on segmentation fault on this particular edge case and you know it's this line that's the problem, you can talk to your friend and say, hey, I'm stuck here because I got a seg fault because this particular edge cases happen. Any suggestion? That's fine. I encourage you to make sure you learn how to implement these two functions, because it allow you all to learn how to use pointers and how to implement some basic data structure, right? So I think this would help. And this doesn't hurt people who did well on the exam. It would even help them even more, right? At the end of the day, if you somehow got everything perfectly, you got about 25 points, right? That's an extra credit. That's a lot. So basically, please learn how to do these things. I actually feel kind of bad for the 63 folks who got into this class without algorithm and without data structure. And I feel like this is a good way to kind of like make sure it's fair for everyone. If you have comments about this policy, let me know, but you all will have right up until next Wednesday midnight. We'll delay the going over the midterm until Thursday the following week. Basically, March 4th, we'll cover the midterm, and that will be when you figure out, okay, this is how I would implement it. And then you go from there. All right. Okay, so that's it for the midterm related things. Now let's talk about one of the big thing in computer that can make things slow. For example, that laptop is one of the bottleneck on everything he's running, the main memory. Right, so we've been doing so many things in the main memory so far. Your program get copied to the main memory when you want to run it, right? We show that in the, when we cover assembly. When you run the program get copied over to DRAM. There's a program counter that point to each line in your code. Data are also there. When you load the files, it's also stored in the main memory. The stack and heap, whatever we covered on last Thursday, is also there. So many things that you do when you write a program involve the main memory. So let's actually dive into this. Let's see what's the trade-off. Let's see what is the ideal memory and how can we design something that would look similar to the ideal memory, right? So what do we want in a memory? Anyone, when you go to say Fortune Town, right, you buy DRAM, what would you like your DRAM to be? What's your desirable thing in your DRAM? As big as possible, right? Definitely more than 4 gigabyte. That's a good answer. I'm gonna like, I think we all would crap on that particular laptop because but basically you want a really large DRAM, right? What else? Well, if you look at the timing, you'll see that the expensive one would be faster. So you want zero latency. I would have to define what do I mean by latency here a little bit. Latency means that how much time does it take to do something. It's the unit of time. For example, if I have to go to the cafeteria and eat lunch, right? I would take a certain amount of time. That's the latency. How much time to run your program to the finish? That's also the latency of running the program. There's also another metric we call throughput, which is, anyone here heard of the word bandwidth? I guess most people, right? Bandwidth is a throughput metric. Bandwidth generally is tied to how many megabytes per second, for example, right? Your internet, if you buy a fiber, these days you get maybe 200 megabytes download speed per second. It means that in 1 second, they'll be able to push through 200 megabytes of data. So that's the bandwidth. It tells the amount, right? So what you want in DRAM is zero latency. As fast as possible is magic. You want this data, it appear right away. You want unlimited capacity, obviously, right? Hopefully you can get that. In reality, no. But this would be something we would want. You want zero cost, right? You want them to cost $0. You want to go and somehow steal that memory and no cop would follow you. It's actually free. What else? You might want to allow your DRAM to serve many, many, many different requests in parallel. This is the bandwidth. This is the bandwidth I talk about. I want high bandwidth for my DRAM. Why do I need that? Anyone here heard about machine learning? I guess Bitcoin machine learning, you heard about it, right? If you use the GPU, the graphic card, to mine Bitcoin or run machine learning, one of the performance bottleneck is a limited bandwidth of your memory. Why is that the case? It actually cannot service as many memory access in parallel at the same time. And there's quite a lot of research going into how can we enable that? How can we allow, instead of 16 accesses at the same time, can we do 32? Can we do 128? It's getting more and more doable, actually. Going forward in the future, you'll see new technology coming in. And these things would enable either fast DRAM, cheaper DRAM, more bandwidth DRAM, or even more reliability. Server machine, right? Don't have a DRAM that's called ECC. What does it stand for? Error correcting code. If you had bit flips on your laptop, what will happen? Anyone want to guess what will happen if you have random bit flips from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0? Blue screen, yes. In many cases, when you saw blue screen that happened, if you are fast enough to look at the error code, sometimes it's actually random bit flip. And in server, you can't throw it at that because people actually pay money to use the server. You can just tell your customer, oh, I'm sorry, it's blue screen. So good luck, have fun, rerun that. You can't do that, right? So what like people at Amazon would do is they'll buy this special DRAM called error correcting code, which actually can throw it up to right now 6 bit of error. So you can have 6 random bit flip. It would correct itself and write the correct data. And all of this, as you might have guessed, right? If you want cheap DRAM, you get small DRAM with it. You get slow DRAM with it, right? You need to shell out more money for bigger DRAM. So these things conflict with each other. You want large memory, it will take longer to access, right? Imagine a room full of people versus a stadium full of people. How long does it take to search someone in a room full of people versus a stadium full of people? a large memory would take longer to search, right? It actually just adds, with everything here we do in hardware is physics that maps, right? So everything here does make sense. If you have large memory, it will take longer to access. Fast memory is also more expensive, obviously. More bandwidth, for example, the DRAM on the GPU would cost more than DRAM that we have on the CPU. And also on top of this, from the programmer point of view, what you want is, obviously you want unlimited memory. You want them to be contiguous. What do I mean? Whenever I call malloc or whenever I call a function, the stack should be next to each other, right? It should be somehow from your point of view, the stack grow on top of each other. The heap will be contiguous. You don't have to worry about when you call a malloc. Has anyone used that address in the middle that somehow you cannot use? So we actually use a technique called virtual memory. You might have heard about the terminology virtual memory. We'll learn in this class on what it actually means. But it gives you this illusion of when you run a program, you have this block of memory to yourself. You have the entire DRAM to yourself. You don't have to worry about, hey, kernel is running right now. I have Chrome open up. What is the address Chrome is using? Can I touch it? It doesn't matter. The OS will manage that through virtual memory. So these are something that the OS and the hardware will work together to kind of provide everything here for the programmer. Okay? So at the end of the day, the programmer will see this illusion, and hopefully at low cost, right? You probably don't want to pay performance cost to get this illusion, but it's more convenient. And we learn how to actually do all this thing, how to make sure memory access are fast, okay? And inside the hardware, make sure you remember this. Inside the hardware, your main memory is a physical thing, it exists. Right? So you have to somehow do multiple trips to give that illusion of my DRAM is fast, my access to the memory is fast, I have unlimited capacity through using the disk, for example. And before we dive deeper into caching, I want to kind of like give a brief overview of the current technology. So this is likely, I can tell you this, I'm not going to test whether you know what's SRAM on the exam, but I really want to tell you what they are, because you might have seen this terminology somehow when you buy, like when you buy a processor, right? So there are two main memory technology. One of them is called SRAM. It stands for static random access memory. These are fast, really fast, but it's really costly. So you don't want many of that because you don't have unlimited amount of money. Another cheaper alternative is what we call the main memory. The memory that you buy is the DRAM. These are cheaper, but slower. So let's look into SRAM quickly, right? Basically, SRAM is what we call two cross-coupled inverter. Basically, it's two inverters. So these are the picture that will show. These thing, if you see triangle and dot, dot mean a not, there is a not in the logical operation. Triangle is passing through. So this is an inverter. If I see one, I'm gonna flip it to zero. If I see zero, I'm flip it to one. You put this in a loop. What will happen to the electrons in this wire? You get amplified using this inverter. You see electrons moving around in circle, and that's it. That's how you store electron inside SRAM. Each inverter is two transistors. Each inverter is two transistors. So right now we are using four transistors to store electron. You just force them to go around in this loop. Then to read it, let's say that electron is a value of one. Right? If there's no electrons, there's a value of zero, low voltage, same concept. To read from it, you have a transistor that would come and read the value. So there are two transistors on both sides. This symbol is, think of it as the method to access whether it's electron or not. Again, will not show up on your exam. I just want to let you know there's a cost related to the cache or the SRAM, right? What's the cost? You need six transistors. Anyone heard about say 3 nanometer technology, 7 nanometer technology, 13 nanometer technology. Those are the size of transistor. So what do I mean by I change from 10 nanometer to 7? It means I shrink the transistor size, right? So with the same area, if my CPU is this big, the next generation will be the same size. It means what? I can put more things in, right? If I shrink the transistor, it means I have more transistor to put in because they are smaller. So that's why it matters to be able to like make this thing small. But SRAM costs 6 of this thing per one bit. Like one single bit would cost 6 transistor, right? So that's quite a bit. It's quite a bit of area, right? So you can't really pay so much money because at the end of the day, you are limited by this area of your CPU. You can't have a CPU about that big. This is too big. There's no way you can drive electron from this side to this side with just 1.5 volts. Too small of a signal. Right? So that's why you need a CPU that big. Another technology is called DRAM. DRAM, essentially, instead of using the inverter thing to trap electrons, it uses a capacitor. What is a capacitor? Anyone heard about this before? A capacitor? It is to store something. So let's say you buy a solar panel, right? If you don't have the battery, it's pretty useless when there's no sun. What do you usually do? You buy the battery to store electrons that you charge up through the solar panel, right? So the same concept applies here. You use a capacitor to store electrons. So it actually just this capacitor. This is a symbol for capacitor, the two like same length thing. Basically, the electron we trap between this gap. If there's electron, that's a value of 1. If there's no electron, value of 0, right? And then there's a way to actually access this through the transistor. So this thing is a transistor, and this is a capacitor. You see, there's only two things, one transistor, one capacitor. It's cheaper. It's cheaper. The charge inside the capacitor would actually flat out represent the value we're reading, right? And anyone use a dash cam in a car, ever seen a dash cam before? So what happens if you stop your engine? It turns off, right? So one of the common types of the battery used for dash cam is capacitor. When you turn it off, electron leaks out. At some point over time, that dash cam will no longer have any battery. This same thing happened to DRAM. We actually have to, every 64 milliseconds, you have to go and rewrite the same value again to make sure the data is there. So this is the overhead of maintaining DRAM. There's a timing related to that. It's called refresh. If you read the main memory specification, sometimes they say refresh interval. That basically tells how often that you have to go and refresh everything. And larger DRAM, the overhead of doing refresh is higher. Let's say you have a 64 gigabyte of DRAM, you spend way more time waiting for this to finish because you have to refresh the whole 64 gigabyte compared to the 4 gigabyte of DRAM, right? And these are all the trade-off with SRAM and DRAM. And at the end of the day, you don't want to break your bank to buy a computer, right? So let's recap what we have here. We have SRAM, it's really fast. So a 512 bytes of SRAM typically takes one or less than 1 nanosecond. If you have a 3 gigahertz CPU, that's about 3 cycles or 4 cycles. So these days, if you look at Intel CPU specification, you see that the smaller SRAM cache would take about 4 cycles to access. The bigger one would take about 10 cycles to access. Comparing to one add operation in the assembly code, you want to add something. That typically takes 1 cycle. So one add versus just one move that you have to go access the data, if you is in SRAM, 3 times higher. You can do 3 adds with the same amount of time. If you have to go DRAM, right? It's a lot cheaper. But now from 1 nanosecond or 3 nanosecond, it's 12 to 50. So in the same amount of time to access the main memory, you can do 40 of those, right? Remember our Fibonacci example where the one that do recursion takes so much time as opposed to the loop one? Because when we call a function, what happened? What happened? We called last lecture on Thursday, right? When you call a function, what do we have to do? There's a call command, right? When you call, you build a stack. You build a stack. Building a stack means you're writing a new item into my memory, right? You have a stack right here. A stack, and you call a function, you write it in, right? Content into this part because of your function call. How many of these are you writing? Quite a bit, right? You need to save the PC. You need to save the base register. You need to save any argument that you're putting in, right? So this thing, each one of them is roughly 12 to 15 nanoseconds. As opposed to our loop implementation of Fibonacci, which is adding, right? So that's the 0.3. That's like a coil operation. So you can see that that's part of the reason why the Fibonacci with the recursion call is taking so long. That's a question that later I record the lecture yet. Yeah, I think I did. Yep, it's up, it's recording. So I'm gonna pause the video as usual. And if I did not, please remind me, sometimes I do forget. But yeah, if you have a gigabyte of DRAM, this takes quite some time. And you saw the real example through a bunch of function calls, right? And now before I move on to how to make this faster, because I want to be greedy, right? I want to have a sheet DRAM. I want to make sure my memory access is fast. What do we do? Before we go to that, let me talk about new technology first. Won't go into your exam at all for sure, but I want to kind of like motivate you that, hey, there's a new thing that might come up in the horizon in the next 5 years. This is already there. If you buy an AMD GPU, they actually put DRAM next to each other. This increased the bandwidth quite a bit. So the last generation of the GPU would use this thing called 2D tiling. What's more, this current generation of GPU, they'll use stacking. They actually put, so if you buy DRAM, right, you buy the main memory, this is what it looks like. It'll be this memory stick, right, with a bunch of chip on it. You saw this thing, right, when you buy you go to the Fortune Town and buy a memory, this is what you see. There'll be pins over here. And this thing, you plug it into your motherboard. You put this thing on your motherboard. This pin, this is one wire. This thing transfer one bit. So you see how wide it is, limit the amount of bandwidth you have. What else? This is where you store the data. This chip is where you store the data. And this is done in just two-dimensional, right? Everything is transferred to this 1D pin. Right now, the GPU is doing this through DRAM. You put this chip on top of another chip, on top of another chip, on top of another one. Way more memory per one single thing. Then you connect this. This is your data will go through this whole stack. This is called 3D stacking. And as you can see, instead of 1D connection, here you have 2D surface to transfer the data over, so you have a lot more bandwidth, right? So this is called 3D stack DRAM. Is a lot of them will be in development for the CPU and server side, but if you buy a GPU, I think the recent one, like the most expensive one, have this. There's also, anyone hear about this thing called Intel Optane? So the Intel Optane used this non-volatile memory technology. This would allow you to have a huge memory, like 2 terabytes of memory, On this thing, it's a bit slower than DRAM, and right now it costs quite a bit. Unless you are a startup company, I don't think you get to buy those things. It actually costs quite a bit. You also have hybrid version of memory where you have the DRAM, 3D DRAM, and NVM. For example, there's a work that I published with a student from UC San Diego that looked into how to combine DRAM, DD DRAM, and this NVM together, this non-volatile RAM, so that you can have at the end 2 terabytes of memory, but it's reliable enough and behave as if they are DRAM, right? If you're interested in this, let me know. I did so. My research group, when I was at CMU, we published, I think, the most number of paper on memory for basically my advisor group, and he's like one of the leader in memory technology. I learned quite a lot from him. So if you're curious about how memory works, let me know after class. Or if you want to do like any projects or like say senior project related on this direction, let me know. Motivational thing aside, right? At the end of the day, memory is slow. One single access takes about 40 at, right? Maybe around, if you think about multiply, it's about 8 multiply. It's quite a lot, right? So even with new technology, we hit a wall. Actually, there's a word called the memory wall. Oh, I'm sorry, you can't see the board. Let me move this a little bit. I'm not sure if that helps. If you still have questions, let me know. I'm so sorry. This is like the overhead of like during this mixed class. So if you guys saw a question pop up on the chat, let me know if possible, because I'm looking everywhere. I'm looking at the board, I'm looking at the screen, I'm looking at all of you, right? So I want to make sure I don't miss the question like this again. Cup.
For the memory, if one side will take a lot of that, what if we make a new technology that acts in parallel subject?
The current DRAM do that. Right now, you remember if you have a main board, right? And you look at the color, sometimes some main board with 4 slots, they'll have 2 colors. Each of the color represent its own connection. So you can operate definitely in parallel 2 accesses. That's first one. It's called memory channel. It's totally separate from each channel is totally separate. It's a totally separate physical connection. So you have double the bandwidth already. Moreover, each DRAM chip that I put here, there is this thing called bank. Right now you are looking at 8 bank to 16 bank. You can do that many parallel accesses per DRAM. So right now in your DRAM on your computer, you are looking at between 8 parallel accesses to 32. That's quite a lot already, but it's not enough for the GPU. That's why GPU needs something like this. This thing has way more memory channel and way more memory banks, so the bandwidth is a lot higher. But yeah, that's a great question. We already did this. It's actually one of the main methods to make sure you can, like, basically make sure your load can be done in parallel. There's also a lot of issue from the processor side, how to issue multiple load in parallel as well, because your program run from first line, second line, third line, right? Go back to your assembly code, you look at the first line, add, second line, add, third line, load. How do you, while you're doing that load, how can you figure out you can go to the next line and do the second load? How can you go to the next line to the third load, right? There's also, that's a design component to the architecture that we actually do to allow, right now, if you look at your computer, it's about 32 to 64 different loads in parallel, right? That's actually multiple techniques combined together to enable all this. Anyway, with the new technology, right, the memory is still slow. There's a limit on how fast you can move electrons. Physical limit. there's a limit on how much distance you can optimize when moving electrons from your motherboard all the way to CPU, right? You actually have to send electrons over. So at the end of the day, this would limit how fast your DRAM can be. On top of it, internally in that chip, there's also a limit on how fast you can move things around. Writing, so the key techniques, let's say you use modern API, that's really fast, right? The way they handle that is to make sure you hide this latency, hide the fact that you are actually loading something. Make sure every time you need the data is fast. So this is what modern API typically will do. Even the compiler, if you compile code in GCC, they'll try to analyze your code and make sure your load and move are fast. There are actually multiple tricks you can do in the program. We are not going to cover the API design. We're not going to cover the design of the compiler, but we'll cover how to take advantage of the hardware to make things look fast. And this is called caching. The size of the data is actually make performance optimization possible. The key here is to hide the fact that you're having to do something long. So to speed up memory accesses, right, I want to be greedy. I want both fast and large memory. What do you do? I can have multiple levels of memory, but we just learned, right? SRAM is fast, but it's costly. I cannot have gigabytes of SRAM. It costs too much. But I can have gigabytes of DRAM. So what do you do? I can put them in a hierarchy. You have the small SRAM. You search the data over there first. If it's not there, you search the next bigger SRAM that are a little bit slower. Then you search, if it's not there, you search the large DRAM and see if your data is there. This way, if your data is in the fast SRAM, you got the data back right away and you can resume running your code, right? So that way you can be greedy. You have both fast and large memory. And here's what the hierarchy would look like. You have a CPU core. So this is whenever you buy a CPU, this is what you see, a core. This is a 3-core machine, right? Because I have a limited area on my slide, I can only put 3 cores. In reality, you have a limited area on your chip. The same thing, you can only put so many cores. The same physical limit applies here. The core would first even have a data access, even have data access. I would go look at the first level cache, which is smaller. This small cache allow a quick access. If your data is there, you are basically returning that data right away. But if the data is not there, you go to this shared bigger L2 cache. Typically L1 cache would take about 3 cycles. L2 cache would be around 10 to 11 cycle. If you have to go to DRAM, that's between 50 and 150 cycle, right? So ideally, the way you design this is to make sure your data that you are likely to access is in the cache. That's the goal, right? From the hardware point of view, you want to make sure the data is in the cache. So let's talk about how do we do that. Any questions so far? No? Yes, so quiet now. So here's a really, really high level overview, right? Let's say, I'm going to use an analogy of I want coffee bean for my coffee. The register that we have is your kitchen cabinet. I can go there, make coffee directly. If I have coffee bean in my kitchen cabinet, it's right there, right? So it's fast. I can make coffee in between classes and you will not notice. And I did that a lot, right? So I can do that in between class. It's fast. This is register files. If you have to go to the cache, it's like I don't have the coffee bean in my cabinet. I have to go to the nearby 7-Eleven. It will take some time. I actually have to walk there, right? And I'm slow. I actually have to actually spend time walking there. So this will take more time, but hopefully with 7-Eleven, hopefully you can see coffee bean there and you can buy it. But in some rare cases, the 7-Eleven doesn't stock coffee bean on that day. Or what do you do? You go to nearby department. Yeah, we go to Lotus, Big C, or nearby department store, right? To get the coffee bean. This is your main memory. What if Lotus and Big C doesn't have it? What else do I do? Well, I mean, you can go to desk, right? It's like I go buy a coffee bean directly from a coffee farm, right? That grows beans and they'll roast it for me. And I can buy coffee bean. So you see the analogy, right? The further away you are from the source, the more time it will take. But at the same time, they will have a lot more likelihood that you find the thing you want. 7-Eleven likely would have the coffee bean. But if they don't have it, the department store should have it because they're bigger. Because they're bigger, they can store more things. So they are less likely to run out of coffee bean. If I go to the farm, I guarantee I'll find coffee bean by definition. Right? The files are there. Your data is there. If it is not there, you can go to network drive, I guess. It's like flying to Brazil to get your coffee bean. And this is the correct analogy because network latency is long. It's not even guaranteed how long you have to spend flying. Right? Sometimes you have flight delay. Same thing with network. You send a packet over, packet get dropped, delay, right? So even how we go to network graph is even longer amount of time. And as you can see here, the policy, if I know that I'm gonna drink coffee every day, twice a day, what would I do? I'll always try to make sure I stock it on at least my kitchen cabinet, right? If not, I'll make sure I know the correct 7-Eleven that's likely to stock coffee bean, right? So that I can get it quickly. And that's the same techniques we use in caching, right? So to use the cache, what we have as the ISA, we actually don't allow the programmer to manually control the cache because that's a lot of things to write in the program. How many of you here got sick of SecVault?
Yes.
I hope everyone is sick of SecVault. Well, actually, I hope everyone is not sick of SecVault because you keep saying that. But I hope you don't like SecVault.
I just want to see the ROI of the sick ball.
You should use GDB for that. You know the exact line that caused the SecVault. No, I'm serious. Basically, if you and yes, you can grow your own coffee bean. Yes, that's also true. Basically, that means I create my own data. Growing coffee bean myself, basically, if you put that in that analogy, it's just a bunch of add and multiply to generate my data, right? So I have data inside the core. So if I want to use the cache, what we decide as the hardware designer is like, okay, there's too much control to the programmer. We'll automatically do this for you so that you don't have to run into another issue of like, okay, who owns that cache? Who owns the data? And is my data there? Can I evict someone else's data? Just say I run Chrome and open Discord and open Microsoft Word, right? They use a lot of memory on your DRAM, which means that they also use a lot of cache. Can my Microsoft Word kick out data on Discord, which kick out the data that's for my Google Chrome? Right? What we decide, okay, fine, you control it. We will ultimately give this thing that hopefully is fast and we'll manage it ultimately in hardware. But today we'll learn how the management is done. And today, Thursday and next Tuesday, so that when you write a program, you can write in a more cache-friendly way. In a way that is similar to the API and library that make sure most of the data access are in the cache. It's possible if you know how the cache is structured. Some type, but this is like a quick caveat, right? Some type of computer actually allow you to manage the cache, like a GPU. So if you program on the GPU, like if you write a complex deep learning inference application, what you end up doing in many cases, you manually control the GPU and manually control the cache. Well, unless you use PyTorch or TensorFlow, but people who implement PyTorch or TensorFlow have to manage the GPU on their own because they know what they're doing. And this allows more optimization for the programmer. Basically, it's a room to make things even faster, right? But it's more complicated. You're not just running into SecOps issue anymore. You're running into, okay, should I use the cache or should I store this somewhere else? It's too much, too many things to consider, right? And before we learn how the cache work, let's go through some basic terminology. So we call our memory instruction, right, that has the data word. A move can move data from register to the main memory. And it can move data from the main memory back to the register. These things have certain size, right? 8 bytes, 4 bytes, 2 bytes, 1 byte of data. The cache also has its own units, but it's bigger. Basically, we call this a cache block. This is defined for different machine. For example, you buy Intel and AMD processor, this is 64 bytes. Some generation of the GPU use 32 bytes, some of them use 128 bytes. Depending on how we configure that, the way we do it, run a ton of application and see what size is the best. It's as simple as that. And actually more and more process toward figuring out what size should it be, but keep it open. Basically in your mind, you should be, cache block has some size. And the size means that I can fit these many bytes of data into the cache block. This is somehow called a cache line. It's the same thing. So if you read article from the internet and if you use the word cache line and cache block all the time, they are the same thing. Just make sure you remember they are the same thing. Each cache block is mapped to some location of the cache. Each cache block is mapped to some location of the cache. That's how you can simplify the search. If you want to go into L1 cache and see where's my data, I can use this mapping to know, okay, instead of searching, so let's say this is your L1 cache, right? The data for address, let's say address 1, will be mapped to certain areas. So for example, this data is located right here. It means that if I have address 1, I will know I have to search this area, not everywhere else. It saves the time on how much you have to search. You don't have to search the entire L1 cache because you know it's only in that area, right? And access is, again, as I said, to this certain area of the cache, you guarantee the data, if they are there, it will be there. If they're not there, go to the next level. The cache hit means your data is in the cache. A cache miss means your data is not in the cache. It's as simple as that. So, quick question, if you write a program, do you want to maximize cache hit or cache misses? So every time you have access to the data, do you want to make sure every time you access it is in the cache or not in the cache? You want to maximize cache hits, right? You want to make sure, hey, every time I access the data, it's in the cache. So in the next lecture, we'll cover what's the policy to manage the cache to try to at least not guarantee, but lead to as many cache hits as possible. But today, let's talk about how do we access the cache first. Here's the example, right? So you have a cache block. So let's assume your cache is 124 bytes. And a cache block is 64 bytes, right? One data word. Let's say if Intel 64-bit processor is 8 bytes. So inside the cache block, how many words are there? All right, can someone do that division for me? 8, right? You have 8 words per cache block, right? And I have 64 cache block. In total, my cache is 1024. How many cache blocks is in my cache? Yeah, it's just 124 divided by 64, right? And I don't, too late in the afternoon, I'm not gonna do that division because I feel like I'm gonna get it wrong. I think it's 16. So you have about, I think, 16 cash blocks on the cash, right? Yep, thank you. So what else do you need in terms of managing the cash? All right, can someone tell me what we need for the cash? The first thing I would need is the data. Obviously, I have to store the data in the cash. Otherwise, the cash is useless. I buy SRAM, it doesn't store data. Why do you even buy it, right? So the first thing you obviously need is the data. Data should be there. But let's imagine this case. If you just store the data and the size of a cache, right, is way less than the size of DRAM, how do you know that the data is yours and it's not some other pointer? You are running multiple programs, right? They all have pointers. The pointer means one address. How can you tell that's your data? You cannot. Then if you just store the data, there's no way you can tell, right? One safest way to do that is you also have to store an address that pair with the data, right? So let's say you have address 0x10. It might correspond to the data 25. Right? So when you have access to 0x10, you look up at the cache and check, hey, is 10 here? If yes, give me 25. If not, I'm gonna go to DRAM and I'll see 25. So the other area to look up the data, you need this thing called a tag store. It's not the entire address, it's just a fraction of your address. And then there are ways to determine how to guarantee your cache is there or not, but doesn't take up the whole 32 bits or 64 bits, right? Why do you want to minimize the number of bits? Everything here are physical thing, it costs money. If you don't have to store those bits, why do you even store those bits, right? It's just wasting money and you should not do that. So there are ways to figure out which bits should be there. And today I'm gonna slowly going through that. So what is inside the cache? Obviously, this address thing, we call them a tag store. A tag store. It store the part of the address so that when you search the cache, you can check if your data is there or not. If your data is there, awesome. You look it up, it's there, you match, and you got your data. If not, you go to the next level, the cache. Another area, we call them data store. So this is just definition. You store the data, so it's in the data store. And this is limited in size, right? To search the data, you use the address. You break the address down into two different portions of the address. Part of it will be the index, which I'm gonna cover in a bit. Another part is the tag. You get the tag, compare that to the tag store. If it match, if it compare and it is the same value, your data is there. What else in a tag store? Obviously it's not on exam, but it's good to know, especially for assignment 4, as your colleagues point out, that these are useful things to maintain in the cache. First of all, you need a valid bit. Why? Let's say you just boot up the machine. The cache is empty. Right? It might store some random junk because electrons sneak into that SRAM cell. So what do? You make sure these are not valid. These are not real data. Make sure they are zero. The tag bit, as we discussed already, should be there. You should have this thing called replacement policy bit. Let's say I have 16 bytes of cache, a really tiny cache. I run Google Chrome and I run Microsoft Word. The replacement policy bit should be able to tell if Google Chrome used 8 bytes, The other 8 bytes occupied by Microsoft Word. This bit will tell if I have the third piece of data that comes in and want to use the cache, which one do I kick out? Do I kick out Google Chrome data or do I kick out Microsoft Word's data? And this is based on the policy we can decide. Basically, we can design the policy to pick the correct block out to make sure we have more cache hits. Because at the end of the day, we want as many cache hits as possible, right? So the choice you make here can lead to different performance. There's this thing called dirty bits. Let's say you run Google Chrome, or let's say you play Dota, right? You kill someone. You modify the data that you just killed this hero, right? They should go to the fountain and wait some certain amount of time. These modifications to the cache have to be propagated to DRAM because the data is not only in the cache, it's actually at two places. There's a real piece of data in DRAM as well. So the dirty bit will tell when do you have to update that data in DRAM. If the data is dirty, it means you have to write it back to DRAM because someone modified my data. So that's what the dirty bit is for. Again, this is not on exam, but I think it's helpful assignment 4, and you can kind of refer back to this when you have to deal with writes, which is the extra credit part of assignment 4. So the main part is dealing with reads. The assignment 4, there's an extra credit that has to deal with writes, and you have to play with dirty bits. Any questions so far before we go to cache organization? All right. So if you have a question coming up, feel free to like basically raise your hand, yell at me, shout stop so I can re-explain things. Also, if I have to, is it clear? By the way, do I have to explain anything again just to make sure? So recap, cache is a really fast memory. You want to make sure your data is in the cache. The way you can determine whether data is in the cache or not, you actually go to an actual example in a bit. The cache organization, basically, if you have say 1024 bytes of cache and a block is 64 bytes, already we just established that are going to be 1024 divided by 64 cache blocks, right? So a cache can contain multiple cache blocks. Each block will belong to a cache set. So what's set in mathematical definition? What is a set? What does a set store? Let's say it's a set of integer, what does it store? A bunch of number, right? Does it store a repeated number? No, right? So that's a set. A cache set works the same way. It store a bunch of addresses. It's also a bunch of cache blocks. You store a bunch of cache blocks in a set, and there's no repeated elements. Each cache block will belong to one set. And the memory address that we see, a pointer, for example, a pointer in C will be mapped to one single cache set. You take the address and it will tell you which set do you go to. For example, here's the example of a cache with 16 cache block, right? As you can see here, cache block 0 to 16. With this assumption that I just draw here, each set contains two blocks. So cache block 0 and 1 will be in set 0, 2 and 3 will be in set 1. The index bit, which is a part of your address, the part of your address will be the index bit. This will point to the cache set. So let's say you have 8 sets in total, how many bits do you need to represent the number from 0 to 7? Zero is 0, 0, 0. 0, 0, 1 is 1. 0, 1, 0 is 2. 1, 0, 0 is 4. 1, 0, 1 is 5. So up to 7 is 1, 1, 1. It means that I can represent set 0 to 7 with 3 bits. Right? 3 bits from the address will tell me the set. So in this case, let's set the index bit equal to 101, which step do I go to search for my data? Data is lost everywhere. So let's say the index bits 101. What's that number in decimal? 5, right? So that's it. You go to set 5. If my index bit is 011, what's the number? 011. 3, right? 3. So you go to set 3. It's as simple as that. You look at the index bit. You know exactly what set you go to and you search that set. If the block is there, you compare the tab. If the tab match, your data is there. So in this case, if index bit is 101, you go to set 5. You would first check cache block 10. Hey, is my data there? If not, check cache block 11. Is my data there? If not, I'm going to go to the next level of the cache. And I'll skip checking cache block 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 12, 13, 14, 15. Bypass of that search. So you see how if I have this set organization, I don't have to search every single cache block for my data. I only have to search a few that correspond to my set, right? So here's one example, the first example. Let's say I have the, so actually before I go through an example, I'm gonna tell you how to extract this index bit and the tag bits from your address. So let's assume your address is 32 bit long, right? And you have 1024 bytes of cache and 4 sets, and then also 64 byte cache block. All right, so with this organization, how many cache block will be in my cache set? You should do computer hardware. I like you. This is like what I think. Quite mad. A bunch of hacking. Huh? Yeah, do like OS and like just an architecture. Oh, okay. All right. Maybe it's the afternoon that's kind of like tiring you out, right? So you have 1024 bytes in cache. There are each block is 64 bytes, right? And there are 4 sets. So in total, you have 4 cache block per set. Basically, the size of the cache divided by number of set multiplied by number of cache block per set multiplied by the cache block size should equal to 1. Otherwise, somehow you have a bigger cache than what you just defined. If you multiply number of sets by number of cache block, by the number of size of each cache block, it should equal to the total size of your cache. Right? So over here you have 4 cache block per set. All right, here's my address. With my address, let me assume that my address can access every byte of my data, every single byte of data. How many bits do I need to tell which byte am I accessing in the cache block? Remember, my cache block is 64 bytes, right? I need to be able to tell each individual location in that 64 bytes. So how many bits do I need for that? It's log of 64, right? It's log of 64 because each bit, let's say you have n bit, you can represent 2 to the n location. So, I mean, yeah, you just need to have different 64 different location, right? So you 2 to the n equal to 64. You want to solve for n, you do log 2 of both sides, n equal log 2 of 64. How, what's the log 2 of 64?
Oh.
I like this. 8 and 4 is just in the middle between, it's 6. 4, 8, 12, 16, 32, 64. So 6 bits, right? 6 bit here. This is 0 bit, 1st bit, 2nd bit, 3rd bit, 4th bit, 5th bit. Here, you use 6 bits to represent each location in your cache. And then, there are 4 sets. There are 4 sets. So how many index bits do I need? I need to tell 4 different locations. How many bits do I need for that? Why 24? You have 32 bits for the address. You need 24 bits already. Actually, think of it this way. The number of bits, let's say that's n, right? Let's say that's n. You want to represent m different number, different location. 2 to the n will equal to m. In this case, 2 to the n equals 4. What is that? All right. You need coffee.
Two.
Two, yes. Right, so you need the 6 bit and the 7 bit to store what we call the index bit. The rest are the tag bits. Right, so in this case, how many tag bits do we have? We have 6 bit for the, I usually call this a byte in block bit. Why do I call it this way? It's telling you which byte are you accessing in the cache block, right? That's why I call it byte in block bit. The index bit is kind of like a default name. If you see that the word index bit, it refers to, if I have the index bit of 0 and 1, this means I'm going to set 1. If I had an index bit of 1 and 1, this goes to set 3. It's just as simple as that. Your pointer, let's say your pointer value is something like this. So this is my pointer, right? And use this same example, the first 6 bits will tell you the byte in block. So what set am I accessing with this pointer? These next 2 bits are the index, right? So what's the value of index bit? 2, right? 2. Because it's 1, 0. So you go to set 2. If you see the pointer, you know what set you're going. It's actually as simple as that. Then the rest thing, the rest of the bit here are the tag. You then use the tag to compare inside the cache. Like, hey, is the tag match? If it does match, it means that's your data. If you go to set 2 and somehow the tag is not there, it means it's someone else's data. And that's it. That's how you can access the cache, right? So let's do another example. Let's say I have 2048 cache size, 16 cache set, 32 bytes per block. And now let me assume my pointer doesn't access every single byte, but it accesses every single 4 bytes. What does it mean? It means that I can access, I say, for example, address 0. I can access address 8. I cannot access address 6 because it's not divisible by 4. Right, I'll go jump by 4 bytes whenever I want to access something. I mean, I can design a machine like that too. So let's say this is our assumption, right? So how many, first of all, the first question, how many cache blocks do I have? Alright, someone do a division for me. It's too late in the afternoon. I need more coffee, actually. But I think it might be it's 2 6. So that's 2 to the 4, 2 to the 5, 2 to the 9, 2 to the okay, 4, 4? Really? Yeah, maybe it's wait, no. Yeah, it's 4, 4, I think it's 4. That's 4 cash block per set, right? 4 cash block per set. How many cash block do I have? It's 20, 48 divided by 32, right? That's number of cash block for the total cash block that I have. Let me write it out. Number of cash block is 20, 48 divided by 32, which is 2 to the 11 over 2 to the 5, right? Which is 2 to the 6, which is 64. A really, really quick trick is convert everything to 2 to the something. Typically, this works better, especially if you're tired and if it's in the afternoon, which is exactly this particular section. Number of cash block per set would then equal, right? So there are 16 cash set and there are 64 cash block in total. So you have 4 cash block per set. If I have an address that are 32 bit, right? How many bits in this case is the byte per byte in block? I want to, okay, let me rephrase the question. My cache block is 32 bytes. I don't care about the first byte, the second byte, the third byte. I only care about the zeroth byte, the fourth byte, the eighth byte. I jump by 4. So how many different locations in that 32 byte range that I want to access? 32 divided by 4, right? You want 8. You want to tell 8 different locations. So how many bits do I need for that? 2 to the 3 is 8, right? So you need 3 bits. So now the byte in block bit would just be this first 3 bit, right? Because the address that I have, I want to save as much address as possible. So I squeeze things in. I don't care about the second byte. I don't care about the first byte. I don't care about the seventh byte. I only care about this 8th location, right? Then the index bit here, because there are how many sets? 16. Block of 16 is 4, right? So you need 4 bits for the index. And the rest are the tag. Let's say my index is 0101, then you go to set number 5. If it's 1101, then you go to set number 13, right? Basically, the number in the index bit, convert that to decimal number, that's the set ID that you go to. It's actually really easy. You just need to, I guess, try this again on your own, and it would be clear that, hey, it actually is not that complicated. So to look it up, as we mentioned earlier, right, the data in DRAM is big. You have 4 gigabytes, 8 gigabytes, 16 gigabytes of DRAM. Your cache is 512 bytes to 56 kilobytes. It's a lot smaller. So not every single piece of your data will be in the cache. What do you do? To look up, right, which is what you just say earlier, it basically means I want to check if my data is in the cache. You divide an address into multiple set of bits, the index bit. In index bit basically tell the potential location of your data. You go to that set, if the tag match, your data is there. If the tag doesn't match, you go to the next level because the data is not there in the cache. The tag bit is the key. If you go in real life, the key will match a lock, right? So if you have a matching key and lock, the lock is your data, the key is the tag. If they match, you got your data. How to get the index bit? As we said earlier, each address, well, some in this case, let's say each address point to a unique byte So every single byte matter, I want to be able to tell the address 1 versus address 3 versus address 7. Then the cache block basically contain many bytes of data. So the byte in block bit is log 2 of that. So that is the first set of bits you take away. That's a byte in block. This is the particular piece of data you're trying to access. Then the next set of bits will be the index bit. Log 2 of the number of set. Log 2 of the number of set in your cache. How do you get the number of set? Let's say on the exam, I'm going to give you something that you divide and multiply and you get number of set. Same exercise earlier. I'm going to have more exercise going into the in-class. Not today, basically once we're done with caching, there'll be in-class exercise for cache. There'll be assignment that you simulate a cache in C. It's actually not that complicated if you understand how this thing works, but it helps quite a lot. Like once you implement this, you know exactly how caching works. Basically, log 2 of the number set becomes the index bit. The rest, tag bits. And let's say you have 16 cache blocks. Each block corresponds to, say, 32 bits tag. The size of the tag store is 23 multiplied by 16. Multiply the two numbers together. That's the size of the tag store. What's the size of the data store? Depending on the size of your data word, multiplied by number set, that's the size of your data store. And that's it for today. We'll continue on to different type of cache in the next lecture on Thursday. What we cover is called set associative cache. There's also direct map cache and fully associative cache. We'll go into the detail on Thursday. Conceptually, they are all the same. It just matter. The only thing that matter of these types are how many blocks do I have in a set? That's it. A four-way cache means I have four blocks in my set. Direct map cache, I have one block in my set. Fully associative cache means I have only one set. Every cache block is in that set. That's it. But I'm gonna visualize them on Thursday. For now, yes. Yeah. The what? Malloc. Right? Yeah, but I am trying to recall the question. So what was the question again? Oh, like a 2D array, right? How do you do 2D array? So do you mind if I write this on this page?
Yeah.
So let's say you want to allocate a 2D array, right? So in the assignment, we have the determinant, right? Which is basically you have metrics, you want to compute the determinant. So basically this is 2D array, right? One trick you can do is you can define int arr of like 10 by 10, right? This is one way you can do it. This is the easy way. But the downside of this is you're fixed with 10 by 10. Sometimes your metrics is 20 by 20, 30 by 20. And then you can do that of that, right?
Yeah,
they have to be square metrics. So one method to go around this problem is to use malloc, right? So basically you can do this, arr, double store. This is what? Let's break this down. This is, star arr is an array of integer. Arr, this is basically array of integer. Arr is what? Is an array of pointer, right? It's an array of pointers. And each pointer is an array of integer, right? So basically you are creating something like this. array of a bunch of array. Each one of them would contain a bunch of integer. But actually, it's actually not representing similar way like this, because each time you go to arr zero, you have to malloc the size of this row, right? So arr equal malloc size of what? Should I do int or star int? Int pointer. If you need a pointer of integer, right? So it's size of int star. Multiply by the dimension. Let's say it's m by n, so you put in n here. Then you loop through arr from arr plus zero to arr plus n minus one, right? Go to from zero to n minus one. Each time you would then malloc size of what? Int, right? Multiply by m. So this would be basically star arr, right? Plus and like plus ISI, right? The j here correspond to which index is which array you're going to. Arr plus j equal malloc this thing. And this is what actually what it would look, oops, sorry. That finger. What it would look like. This is arr of zero. Another separate array would be arr of one. You don't have to actually make it the same size, right? Each pointer here points to an array. It can be size m, which would give you the 2D array. You can somehow do this size m, m plus one, m plus two. I don't know, you just want to throw around and play around with this dynamically allocated array. So you essentially have a separate array for each pointer. Well, yeah, that's not how you can create a 2D matrix in C. Huh? Yeah, I told you that in through the Q&A, right? And the other thing is you can then refer to like say this entry, which is the J K entry of J, right? By doing this. This will give you the J's entry in the array. Give you the K's entry of the array J. So you can then use this double bracket to refer to the correct item in your 2D array. Yeah, so that's kind of like how to deal with 2D metrics. All right, any questions before I move on to Discord and start the in-class exercise? Okay, so for those who are online, I'm gonna switch over to Discord so you can join us. Basically, let's work on in-class exercise 9, which is a bunch of assembly. Email question, if you're here, raise your hand, I'll check and go through the question we have. Thank you.